Hey, Hickok 45 here, and son, right?
Yep. I think, yeah.
Okay, you think right. So? Yeah. At least that's what we told you. Yeah, you guys made comments and wrote me and said that you kind of liked the 1,000th video where we both just sat out in the woods and said stupid stuff. So why not? So for this vlog, we're both here. So if one of us isn't dumb enough, we can double down on it. And what I don't think of, John will think of. So we can totally bore you and stupefy you. How's that? So, but anyway, I don't know. We'll talk about some stuff here. It's a vlog. And what do you want to talk about, John? You know anything?
I didn't know we were going to talk about anything. I thought they said they wanted to see us out in the woods again. They didn't say they wanted to hear us talk.
Well, what are we doing out here? Let's think of something.
Well, that hickory nut looks good.
That come off the tree?
There's an ant on it. It's added protein. It's a plus.
I bet it came off that maple tree. We really ought to talk about something. What do you think? Don't eat that.
That's hard. What's that pumpkin there for?
Oh, what about that? We could talk about that. There's an ant on it. Yeah, we could talk about the pumpkin. How's that? Okay, we do have something to talk about. You recognize this guy, don't you? Yeah, we slung some lead through him a couple days ago, I guess now. Still looking pretty good.
It's more of an ant house than a pumpkin now, though.
Yeah. Yeah, really. I hope he lasts till Halloween so we can scare the little kids with his ugly face. Put a candle in there. So, yeah, hopefully you, I know a lot of you have caught all the pumpkin carvings probably. If not, why have you not? I usually link all of them in the description. Because if you enjoy pumpkin killing, pumpkin carving, they're pretty much all there, okay? What, 5-6 years worth? Is that right?
Yeah, I believe we've done 6 of them so far. It's hard to believe.
It's amazing.
And still, this is the best that we can do.
That's
after
right.
6 years. You haven't gotten any better at it?
Hey, all you need is a couple of eyes, a nose, and a mouth, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Well, people are kind of, you know, I've noticed people are really slow learners. And so they need to be reminded every year how you properly carve a pumpkin. So we just keep up the education. And I think more people are getting the message now. It seems to. I've seen comments where people say they're actually doing it the proper way now. So that's kind of nice to know, isn't it?
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
an impact.
It is. Yeah, I've seen some people online that have figured out how to do it the right way and the safe way, of course.
Except, I bet the folks who sell knives are not happy, or Band-Aids.
Yeah, that's true.
A lot of people still using sharp instruments to carve their pumpkins. So, anyway, yeah. we're just regular comedians, aren't we? But this is a piece of history that we... YouTube history. No YouTube history goes back too far, does it?
Yeah.
But it is a piece of history for us that's kind of interesting because it's just something so like what we've always done. And who knew? I think it was the second year before it really took off, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was the year that it got put on TV. And
all over the place.
All that. I'm not sure if that's still around or not, but there was this thing that used to be, the people used to watch called television.
Yeah.
And it was like this box that would sit in your room.
Oh, yeah.
And you'd turn it on, and there'd be like people. It wasn't good, of course, but there was people that have shows and things like that on there. And they actually showed one of our pumpkins on there back when they used to have that.
So. That's right. Back on, on various little shows. I mean, that's not why we did it. You know, we did it the first year. And,
but it was cool.
It was back cool.
When people watched TV, it was cool.
Yeah. So, but anyway, you know, we'll continue doing that regardless. It's just something. I mean, how else are you going to make a jack-o'-lantern? You know, duh,
yeah.
Everybody makes a jack-o'-lantern. I've been doing it my whole life. So so that's pretty neat. And, you know, it's a good use for a firearm.
A knife, it just takes too much time. Just takes too long, too dangerous.
Messy. You get that stuff all over your hands. I hate to even think about it.
Yeah.
I remember back in the really old days using a knife occasionally, and it was really difficult to get the right knife, you know. One that was thin enough, you could get all the way through the pumpkin and cut the eyes off.
Yeah, and it felt like a chore, too.
Yeah.
That's the other thing. It wasn't fun.
You're right. It was a job. Here was a Halloween, an annual event that a lot of people enjoy, trick-or-treating, all that sort of thing. Some people don't, but I think most people do. And cutting a pumpkin, it's all part of it. And I always have kind of enjoyed it, but yet I never really did look forward to carving the pumpkin, you know, until I figured out the correct way to do it. So, but yep. Anyway, that's one thing we were going to talk about. Since it's here, don't know how it got here.
And I hope you guys saw the pumpkin killing. Yeah. And if you saw the last one but I haven't seen the others, check those out, because those are fun. That's my favorite part of Halloween is yeah. pumpkin killing.
Yes, because we put a fair amount of time into all that killing.
Yeah,
there's a lot of pumpkins get murdered, and it's where, in fact, I was telling John, I just got a message yesterday on Facebook from a fellow, said that he and his 5-year-old son were out riding around the day before, I guess, going somewhere, and there were some pumpkins smashed in the road. And you probably are watching this, if you wrote me on Facebook, you know who I'm talking about. And his 5-year-old son said, look, Hickok 45 had been here, or something like that.
We probably should have thrown those in the woods instead of the road, I think.
Well, yeah, I know. Yeah, that's where we dumped them out. So, yeah, that's the part I wasn't going to tell you, that it was a guy just down the road a few miles where we dump all of our trash in the road. But anyway, that was pretty funny. But it further reinforces the fact that John and I are meeting our goals. We are ruining the minds of young people all around the world, aren't we?
Yeah.
We're corrupting the minds.
We really are.
Not just you old folks, but young people. So, but anyway, pumpkins, we enjoy them. And we have a few more yet, so you never know.
We need to start growing them. When are we going to do that?
Yeah, I think they already know about our pumpkin patch, maybe. You can't hide that. So anyway, what else are we going to talk about? Anything? We're going to have to sit and carve a hickory nut and figure out something else?
I don't know.
Well, what about the Hickok 45 and Sun Station? Channel.
Station?
Yeah, well, you know.
That's right, yeah.
That goes back to those old days of TV, right?
That's right. I used to watch TV.
Yeah.
So if you guys haven't checked it out, we created a while back a secondary channel, Hickok 45 and Sun. I've been doing, as some of you may know, I've been doing some radio shows over there. They're not good, but they're there. And I have recently created a, I'm trying to make it into a podcast. If you look on the most recent one, I think it's number 7, which is probably the worst one of all of them, but it's there. There's a link in the description to take you to where the podcast is downloadable. It's not on iTunes yet, but it will be eventually. I'll get it on there. And if you love really horrible radio and you have to have it on a podcast, that's now available. So just so you know, and I'm gonna, you know, both of us are gonna eventually, you'll come over there and do some things. For now, I've just been doing some random things over there. And that's been fun. So.
I think I'll just sit here and let you tell. It's kind of nice having John around talking, you know, because I can just sort of sit here and listen to him, take some of the pressure off. As I've told you all before, you know, when you're doing these vlogs, unedited vlogs, it's kind of weird if you do stop and can't think of something to say. At least on the recorders on radio shows, you could kind of hit pause for a second. But, you know, I should do that more often, right? But it's kind of nice having John to say something intelligent along with me, saying something dumb. The other thing we've been doing is, you've noticed we've gotten some sponsorship, which we've talked about, and we've had a lot of firearms lent to us. And again, it's because you guys watch us, it's great, and it helps us bring some firearms to you, like this one. Well, actually, I bought this one. Just so you know what I've got, by the way, this is a Springfield. Well, it's a Remington, actually, but it's the OT3, and it's the A3, okay? As I sit here with it, we may talk about it later. Who knows? One of my favorite rifles. I haven't had it too long. Bought it in Louisville at a gun show. So just so you'll know, you won't be sitting there thinking, what gun does he have? What gun does he have? And you're missing all the brilliant comments from John or me. But yeah, we've gotten some sponsorship lately from Bud's Gun Shop, and we're really pleased with that. You know, I think I've told you before in the radio shows, most recent one especially, talked about that. Some people are more video oriented though, and they might not listen to the radio shows. I think, you know, speaking of radio shows, I think there's a connotation there of boring, you know, if it's just audio, because we are in a visual world, you know, don't have to tell anybody that, but really, I've listened to John's and he talks about some interesting things. Occasionally I stumble up maybe and talk about something interesting, you never know. And I talk about the videos and things that we do and why we do things. So for folks that that don't seem to get it or understand what we're doing, it's a good place to go, because, you know, we're doing a video on a rifle or a pistol. Well, you know, we pretty much stay on topic, but in the radio shows we talk about all sorts of things.
It doesn't have to be as information based.
Yeah.
It can be more just food for thought kind of stuff.
Yeah. And a little bit like these, the vlogs, but different too. And I mean, just ramble about anything.
Yeah. It's easier to relax too. That's one cool thing about radio. Anytime there's a camera in your face, you're never going to be 100% yourself. It's just impossible unless you are a highly trained actor. It's just not possible. But on radio, you get it. You can, because it's just you sitting in a room talking to a microphone, it's a little easier to kind of just relax, be yourself. So you get more of that element with the radio, which is maybe part of what makes it so bad.
That's right. Like you said, unless you're a highly trained actor like myself.
Right, right.
We don't have to. If you've seen enough videos, you know that there's no danger of our being highly trained actors. Oh, man. I think back of Saving Destiny from the Zombie, or killing the zombie snowman right down there. Yeah. Acting is never my forte, but anyway, back to the topic. Yeah, catch the radio shows, because we talk about a lot of these things, and at least for those of you who have interest, you know. And I think one of the things too in the radio shows, we assume that people who are even more interested in what we're doing, or how would you say, more loyal, you know, viewers, people that really just want to know more, are listening. Just like watching, you know, these. So we probably let our hair down a little more, don't we? John's got a lot of hair to let down. I don't have much to let down.
I don't ever put it up, so it's always down.
But, yeah, I mean, really, we do. We let our hair down. We always tell it like it is, but in a radio show, we can talk a little bit more frankly, because there's no rush and there's no camera. Right.
And, of course, in the videos, we are natural. We are coming off as natural and just being ourselves as we can. But still, when you're on camera, you don't want to look too much like an idiot.
Like a fool.
Right.
Like a fool that we are.
Right, because, you know, you're moving around, you're manipulating firearms, and thinking about what you're going to say. But on radio, it's just more relaxed. You're sitting in a big comfy chair or couch, and just talking about things that come to mind.
Yeah, it's different. I mean, I guess it sounds like we're plugging our radio. We didn't even mention that or think about talking about it, but it just sort of came to mind. I was talking about our sponsorship, and I talked about that in the most recent radio show, and I even put a kind of a link to that or mentioned to it in a comment recently on a video. I had a troll get upset with us for being a sellout or something, and so I was trying to get him to that radio show so he could kind of listen to what's going on. He didn't even know what's going on. We've discovered there are people who don't really, I think, maybe understand some of the stuff that does go on, like what's a T&E gun and all those sorts of things. And
the term sellout is kind of crazy. The term, I don't know what the official definition of it is, but the way I see the term sellout is it's when someone sells something that they shouldn't sell, right? Like, you don't go into a store or gun shop and say, oh, look at these sellouts in here selling guns, right? Like, they intended on selling that. Selling out would be if they let someone, let's say a gun shop, let some anti-gun group set up some kind of, I don't know, promotion in their shop, right? Yeah. That's being a sellout, because they're selling out their beliefs, basically. They're selling something that they should not sell. They're there to sell guns. They're not. They're going against their beliefs, the whole thing, reason that they got into that business. And we're not doing that, because we're not. Our videos, we are, the reviews that we do on guns and all those kinds of things are sacred. Nobody's going to touch those.
No way, no how. I think some people, don't you think some people, they think in terms, well, there is a small, very small segment, I think, of society that thinks that anything you might do that would generate income or something free, you know, then you're being a sellout, you know. So I don't know what you're, like, if you're watching an episode of Breaking Bad and there's a Walmart commercial, I mean, I don't know, is that a sellout? They're sponsoring the show.
Right.
That's why you're seeing it. So I don't know. There's some people who just are so anti-business of any kind that they just throw that term around, or they're just haters looking for a read. But and of course, you know, it's a tenth of a percent or less than that. But anyway, we get a lot of questions about what's a T&E gun. We do an FAQ on that. I think we might have so. At one point.
Yeah.
But that question comes up periodically as you see it. So but anyway, we get support from various sources, and we're happy to get that support, because one thing John and I are committed to is, and we didn't mean to talk about this so much, but we are committed to remaining really clear with what we're doing and transparent, you know, as much as anybody can. You're going to know it. That's one of the differences. I think that's one reason we'll get a hater comment occasionally, because we're so upfront with stuff. I guess
we tell you if we get a free gun.
Yeah,
we don't have to do that, but we want you to know, because if I was watching a YouTube channel, I would want to know. If I was watching a video on any kind of product, I don't care if it's a coffee maker, if that guy got that for free, I would want to know that. It doesn't mean I'm not going to trust it, but I'd like to know.
Right. Yeah, exactly. He may give the best review on that coffee maker you've ever seen.
Right.
But it's just something you'd want up there in your brain.
It puts the ball in my court. Yeah. So I can decide, okay, do I still trust this person because he got this for free?
Yeah.
I get to decide that, because I know. Well, if I didn't know, then I can't even make an accurate decision.
Exactly. And, you know, on the same topic, the marketing world is getting so sophisticated.
Very, very
I still do watch some TV, you know, watching the news. It's interesting to me.
So it is still around.
Yeah, okay. It is still around. And what I'm noticing more and more, is you'll see an interview on the news or a morning show or something, whether it's Fox or CNN or whoever it is, you know, and there'll be this interview, and they'll be all set up in posing chairs, and they'll have this doctor in, and they're going to talk about some dangerous nutritional supplement or something that kids are eating that might be causing danger to them. And so as you start watching it, you think, okay, it's interesting. What's this about? What is it that maybe kids shouldn't be getting access to or something? And they go into it could be a 5-7 minute discussion interview, and this expert's talking about it, and you may actually be learning a little bit, you know, and you think, okay, it's interesting. That's why they're doing this interview, because this is an issue that might be of interest to people, and it could even be some danger, or who knows. But then as they get towards the end of the interview, you realize whatever it is that was so bad,
like the guy that started
doctor,
the company is
this
there
doctor happens to, he happens to have a book about it, and he happens to have developed this alternative cereal that doesn't have that in it. And then I get it. But right. A lot of people don't.
And I believe in just being honest. You know, we don't need all these, we don't need to create all these boundaries between each other. Just say, okay, maybe he does have a book that he does want to sell, but he believes in it, and he wants to provide people with information that he's very knowledgeable about. Just come out and say, okay, I've written this book. I think it's a very good book. Yeah. Here's my experience. Here's why I've written this book. Here's why I think the information is good. And here's why I think that you should be interested in these products. Take it for what it is. Why can't they just do that?
Good point. Just have the guy on as a, okay, so-and-so's here because he has this book. And I don't know if they would admit that he's paying them or whatever, but to advertise his book, but that would be good too.
Right.
And
I don't need to know dollar amounts. I just want to know I want to know what the deal is.
I've got a book on this, and I'm selling this cereal, and I think it's best for this reason, that reason, and take it or leave it. But at least you know where he's coming from. But anyway, all that, I guess, is a long way around the barn to just kind of remind you that the reason we let you know whether a firearm, and we've done that from the beginning on the T&E guns, haven't we? It's this gun came from Glock, or this gun came from Ruger. This is a T&E gun, you know. We do a chapter two with it, and then maybe something else. And then,
those go back.
And then we send them back.
Unless you want to buy it.
Or I purchase it.
And really, I mean, there's basically four ways that we get guns, right? Personal collection, borrowed from someone.
From a viewer.
From just a viewer, just someone we know. And then T&E, and then a gift, which...
Right. Donation.
Right.
Yeah, to the cause. And I mean, that's kind of where they all come from. And we mention that in every video. I think the only places we might ever not is if we've got a firearm, we talked about it extensively, everybody knows where it comes from, you know, by now we're doing the fourth video with it or something, and it's a woods walk.
Right,
and
we not every video it. We're going to remind yeah. people that we yeah. we just want to make sure that information is available yeah. in the main video.
Right, so I mean we're not perfect or anything, but we just try to let you know what's going on. And
if you want to know, ask.
Yeah.
If you're watching a video and you want to know if it was a free gun or if it was a T&E gun or what, and we're not yeah. clear about it, just ask and we'll yeah. try to answer it.
Absolutely. It should be in the description. If I realize from your question that, oh, it wasn't in the video or the previous five videos on that gun, I'll put it in the description and this one too or something where it came from. And sometimes if it's a firearm that's a T&E testing evaluation, you know, from a manufacturer, then I'll purchase it so I'll still have it. As I have done with a few, especially Glocks, I have purchased some Springfields, and if you're anybody's laboring under the illusion that I get them for $50, sorry, they're probably the same price you would pay for them used at a gun show or a gun shop.
They are technically used.
I'm yeah, they're used, but it's high, you know, especially on Glocks. I mean, man. I have not purchased a few just because I felt like I could beat that price at a gun show. You yeah. know, really, you know.
You know another thing I thought of too is I know some people might think that with the T&E guns, the ones that come from the ones that go that are sent back or bought at wholesale prices that come from the major manufacturers, some people think that, oh, these guns were hand selected for us, right? I've heard that. Now here's the thing, maybe. That could be true. I don't know. I'm not in that factory. I don't know. But we've had experiences with guns that we got on T&E that yeah. didn't work that right, like the Ruger American.
That's right.
That was T&E. It didn't work right. The bolt stuck, couldn't get it open, sent it back. And they sent us another one.
I mean, a good one. We mentioned that in the video. Yeah.
So maybe, but honestly, I don't think so. I don't think they really even care enough to do that.
I don't either. I don't think they have the manpower. The personnel to do right. that.
And also, they'd have to test the guns.
And when we get them, they're
pretty obviously brand new, never been fired.
Yeah.
You can tell that they haven't really been fired, except for maybe the test firing. But they'd have to actually do some pretty serious tests on the gun to figure out if
there is a problem or going to be a problem.
Right. So I'm not going to say that, but I'm sure that doesn't happen because I don't know. I have no idea. But in our experience, it doesn't seem to be the case at all.
Yeah, it doesn't seem to be. I can really understand why people would suspect that. I might suspect it too, if I had not been on the side of it. But it would make sense, you know. Well, yeah, I've seen people make those comments on videos before. Well, you know, before they're going to go into Hickok, they've tested that thing and looked it over and all that. And like John says, there might be someone that has done that.
It may have happened.
Some of them. Yeah. But I really honestly don't think they have the time or even care enough.
Yeah.
I really don't.
There's been times where we've said, why didn't they check this thing?
Should have. And they get mad because they didn't. I don't really want a piece of junk.
Yeah.
I want something that's representative of the company. Yeah. For example, you get a Ruger in, or you get a Glock or a Smith & Wesson or a Springfield, whatever, and it doesn't work, or there's something crazy going on with it. It's almost frustrating right. because usually that doesn't happen. Right. Why did I get this bad?
Because there's a point to where if yeah. a gun doesn't, like, just flat does not work, if it malfunctions, like, every magazine, that's not an unreliable gun to me. That's a gun that doesn't work.
It's broken.
It's broken. Yeah. There's something wrong with it. Yeah. It's not that it's just unreliable. So it's not like we get a gun, oh, this gun's a little unreliable. It's not. Put it in a video. It's not like that. Don't get that idea. It's just if a gun literally just does not work.
Yeah.
Right. I mean,
and we've talked about that before. Yeah. I, you may disagree, but our policy is if we get sent a gun from a reputable company, their guns work. It's Ruger, right. Springfield.
You may argue about how reliable it is, how yeah. good it is, how durable it is over time.
But if it just doesn't work.
Pretty much every gun, even the some of the worst ones. I mean, they work to an extent.
Yeah.
I mean, they're going to shoot most of the time. So when you have one that doesn't shoot most of the time, then okay, there's something really seriously wrong.
You can't get it to work. And but I've talked about before how we're not in the business of doing bashing videos and getting in and say, I say we get a Glock 19 sent. I don't know what it'd be now. They got a Generation 5 coming or something.
Yeah.
And the thing just doesn't work. Well, now that might be accurate. If it's a Generation 5, maybe it is. They need to look at it. But I don't know what better example of it. Just a gun that everybody knows works. And an 870 Remington or something. And despite the recent quality control issues, but we get one sent in here and it just won't cycle even one round or something, or every other shot it won't cycle or something. Well, our position on that is the 870 is a proven shotgun. Remington, at least in the past, has been, or it's a Mossberg, you name the company, and it just won't work. We're probably not going to do a video with that stupid gun. We're going to send it back and say, hey, look, you got a problem with the gun, you know, and send us one that works. Now, we'll probably mention in a video that, hey, this is a second, like we did with the Ruger rifle. We had a problem with one, which can happen with any company. We got a serious lemon. If we went ahead and did a video with that shotgun, Mossberg, Ruger, whoever, Remington, well, we could get a lot of views. Oh man, we got an 870. What a piece of crap these things are. They don't work, you know. And we could give it a really sexy title and everything, and we get a lot of views on it.
It's just not fair. It's not that it's not fair to the company, which of course it's not fair to the company, but
it's not fair to
you guys. Yeah. You guys behind the camera, it's not fair to you because it might get you all riled up. Oh, I'm never buying an 870. Well, they might be a great gun.
Or you might be relatively new to firearms. It just hit me. And you don't know the tradition and the history of the 870 Remington, for example, but you've been watching enough of our videos that you trust us. I don't know why that would be.
Yeah.
But we actually have some credibility with you, you know, and you see that video and you're like, well, man, Hickok 45 and John say that's a junk gun or it doesn't work for them. I'll never buy one of those. And so you wouldn't get an accurate depiction of the Remington 870. So anyway, that's our philosophy, and that's what we would do. We would send it back like we did with the Ruger. We'd let you know about it, but then we'd go ahead and do the review with the next one that would work.
Also, when it comes to testing, I guess you could look like our tests, if you call them now, our guns, they're really short-range tests. And a lot of it's opinion-based and things like that. Like, if you really want to figure out, like say a new gun that's come out that no one knows anything about, if you really want to test that gun and find out is that a viable option compared to a long-standing gun in the same category, you're going to need at least probably four or five different ones. You're going to need to put thousands of rounds through each one, test them in actual harsh conditions that really affect the way the gun functions, things like that, and then it's going to depend on your use and all that. So that would be pretty elaborate, talking about thousands of dollars to test a gun like that. We can't do that. The best we can do is give you a nice short range test, put a decent amount of rounds through it, see if the gun works, figure out, you know, does it seem ergonomic, does it shoot well, all that kind of stuff. Is it reasonably accurate? Best that we can tell. And also, what we also do research on the internet. What have we seen about it? What have we heard about it? Things like that.
Yeah, good. Exactly. And you all know that, you know, firearms test and evaluation, T&E, as I've told y'all before, and again, new shooters or people not as savvy about the, business world or marketing world. And interesting. I always say when people ask about T&E, what's that mean? Where do you get your T&E? It always comes out of the marketing department or the sales department, T&E guy. So that should tell you what you need to know about that, right? So it's not like companies are sending out a firearm for any of us, magazine writers or YouTubers, to actually test to see what they need to do with this gun, if it works or not, generally speaking. Now, they might send a few out through there as a prototype to somebody, I don't know, unless we've got anything like that.
Well, now the Navy SEALs, they send us a bunch of stuff.
They always send us their stuff. But it comes out of marketing, actually. And so T&E to magazine writers and us and people like us, if there's anybody like us, it is for the exposure. Yeah. You all know that, and we know that, and nobody makes any pretenses about that.
Oh, we don't care.
The beauty of it is we get the latest Glock or Springfield or Ruger in that we want, that you all ask for, and we get to shoot it and let you know what we think about it and how it works. So,
and like I mentioned, we have four different ways that we get guns. If we lose one of them, we'll be fine. You know, so we're not going to feel like we have to say certain things about a certain gun because we're afraid, oh no, we might not get more of those. Doesn't matter.
That's the advantage of having the support. We really got down this trail. We didn't mean to get down. that is the advantage of having sponsorship, you know, and having some companies help us out, like some of the gun shops that you've seen have sent us firearms, like the Gun Parlor in Massachusetts, a really great outfit that sent us 3 or 4 different firearms and as
Buds,
gifts.
Of course.
Buds, of course. Buds has sent us more than any. That's why, and I think some people don't fully understand, you got different levels there. We've got several gun shops around the country. What's it, Mays Arms and Archery sent us the firearms, Top Gun Supply. These are donated firearms. And Buds, no one has sent us more than Buds Gun Shop and done more for us than Buds. They are a substantial supporter, and that's why they get a lot of plugs. You know, we don't mind doing that because it does not affect what we do. And yeah, we don't run 2-minute commercials on videos and all that stupid stuff. And but we don't mind plugging the people that help us. Federal, of course, helps us a lot. And but anyway, we have lots of sources, and so it's great because I know the first year we did this, I have a nice little collection of firearms, but we got to a point there where we were trying to figure out, we wanted to continue doing this, and we've talked about this before. Well, let's see, we got the Beretta, we could trade that for a gun and then do a video with that gun, and the next week we could trade that for something else, or the next month or whatever. But being able to get the firearms as easily as we have, and again, mostly because you guys are watching, we're able to do more firearms, if you've noticed, in the last 6 months.
It's helped us have a nice library.
Yeah, really, and more comparisons and all that. And we didn't really mean to talk about this a lot. Mainly, wanted to explain that T&E business, and then, again, the Bud sponsorships, which is significant and really helpful. And we're never going to be affiliated. We're not going to be affiliated with too many companies because we're not going to clutter up our channel.
I think we should make it like NASCAR.
Yeah, really.
I think
good idea.
Any available space, there should be an ad.
I think so.
I think we should on
the
your
gong.
Hat.
The gong is going to be the Home Depot gong.
You could even get a tattoo on your forehead.
I know. I think
the guns.
Swinging plates.
The guns. We need ads on the guns. That's right. Valuable marketing space not being taken advantage of.
Hey, John is joking, but there's no limit to the money we could make on doing stuff like that if we wanted to ruin the channel, right? No, we, I'll tell you, our philosophy and all that is, we walk up support, okay? No doubt about that, because we have a lot of stuff going on, and I'm not teaching anymore, and this is what we do, really. And, but doesn't matter. We're going to keep the channel like it is, and we want to get support from selected companies. We've actually targeted them.
That's the thing, too. Yeah. The ones that we like.
The ones we like that we know we have visited. And we have it's just a handful total. There's not much we can do. We're limited in what we can do in terms of sponsorship because we've turned down all kinds of things. I can't even talk to you about it. And some of the reality shows and all this kind of crazy stuff because that's not what we want to do. We're going to crank along with what we do. Little with minor tweaking so that we can generate some more support, but it's going to be minor. And if it's a company that's helping us, then again, hopefully if they're friends of ours, that I'm not telling you go buy from them, but I hope you at least understand, because no company's perfect. Whether it's the gun shops that have given us guns, I'll get a message occasionally about some gun shop that gave us a firearm or helped us with a T&E gun or something. Hey, I've been to a gun shop and wouldn't take this gun back or something. You know, like, I'm sorry, you know, there's no business that's perfect, whether it's Bud's or Brownells or Walmart or you name it. I can't name a business. You can Google any company. How did we get off on this? You could Google any company, your very favorite company. You could Google... who makes the best cars? Mercedes? I don't know. Never had one. You could Google Mercedes problems and open up 40,000 pages, right?
Right.
Or Rolls Royce problems, or Google whatever would take you to customers who have trouble with their Rolls Royce or their Mercedes or their Volvos or their Volkswagen or Buds or Brownells or Midway or anything like that. You know, so. I don't know, we got awfully wordy about all that, but we wanted to just say that we that is one of the things that's been going on. We've gotten a little sponsorship, and
it's all in transparency. We just want to be clear. We want you to know everything. We want you to know what we're thinking, where we're coming from. We want you just to know, if you care, we want you to know what's going on.
Yeah, bottom line, that's it. You're going to know. You're going to know with us. where we get stuff and that kind of thing. And if I'm exceedingly praiseworthy of a particular firearm, and you think that he's just saying that because it's it was free or we got it from whatever source, then
that's their right. Yeah, it's your right to think that.
At least it's not hidden. Okay?
But I would encourage you, if you feel that way, to go around and watch some of the other videos where we've done free guns, and use that to kind of help you with your judgment. Because it's going to be totally random. There will be some guns that we get that are free where it will look like absolutely love it because it is a really good gun. There'll be some that maybe we don't like as much. So
it's totally based on the firearm. There's no doubt about that. I know there's some people have given us firearms that they may not be as friendly with us in the future. I don't know when I look at the videos and what I thought of the firearm, and that's another point. If you're watching and you own a gun shop or whatever, and you would like to send us a firearm, I'm not getting ready to ask you for firearm. What I want to tell you is that don't do it if you don't want to see an honest review, because that's just what we do. It's whatever my opinion. It might be, I think it's the greatest firearm since sliced bread, or it might be something I just don't like that much. But then again, if it works, and then my other side of that too, the other side is most firearms work, and mostly the negatives come down to ergonomics and weird things like
the
that.
The use of it for your personal use.
How it shoots, how it used. My least favorite firearm might just be your favorite. You know, like, we don't know this, all the arguments on the internet about 1911s versus Glocks and everything else. So one man's trash, another man's treasure. So you always have that going on. But anyway, you just want to kind of talk about that for about a minute. That would turn into 20 minutes probably. What else is going on? What have you been doing?
Nothing. Nah, we had some fun with some cool guns. We had the SCAR with the suppressor on it was fun.
That was. Thanks to NC Silencer, we're able to bring you guys some cool stuff there.
Yeah, suppressors are a lot of fun. I enjoy those things. Before we started doing this, I'd never shot a suppressor before.
Yeah, I had, but not much. And it's something I'm not driven to own a bunch of them. Thankfully, with NC Silencer helping us, we can show you some things periodically that take suppressors or suppressors or even select fire things. They're a lot of fun. I guess they're at that percentage of the shooting hobby, whatever, 5% or something. Some people really get into it. And if you want to see more of those, go to Knob Creek Machine Gun Shoot. And you can find anything you want.
And there's a lot. One thing that's cool is a lot about suppressors that you just can't know unless you've experienced or maybe watched videos on them and stuff like that. But there's a lot about suppressors you just don't get from the movies, like how dirty they are, how dirty they make the guns, the gas blowback in your face, and how hot they get, and how long they take to screw on. A lot of times, unless you have a quick attack. I mean, there's so many things about them that you just don't get from the movies.
Yeah, really.
And I'm sure I had a lot of those delusions before I ever shot them. And very quickly, you could, this is a little different than I thought.
That's right. Hollywood gives us a different picture sometimes. Oh, they're cool. Not to talk you out of them. They're pretty cool, depending on what kind you get and what the firearm is. You get a lot of blowback into your system from them, and it gets dirtier much faster. Yeah.
Like with that MP5, I remember once the gun was getting really dirty, firing a whole magazine, I think it was like getting pepper spray in the face.
Oh, yeah.
Which I have before, so I know what that's like.
Really, have good glasses on, good shooting glasses before you fire those things, because you get, not lead, I don't guess, but you're getting just powder residue and stuff back in your face, your eyes occasionally. It's just the nature of it. But those are pretty cool. That SCAR, still like that, man. That thing is sweet. Yeah. Got that new trigger, the Geisley in it, and I just posted the chapter 2 over here on the hill, and man, that was fun. It was interesting. I was watching that video just this morning after I posted it, and hearing the 308 rounds hit those thick steel targets, because that's one thing a suppressor does that's so interesting to me. That's why you hear me laughing so much when I shoot those things over on the main range, is it's just odd.
Yeah. It gives you a new respect for the power of some of these rounds, too.
Yeah, because you rarely hear the bullet hit.
Right, you hear them thud into the steel and all that.
You see them hit whatever you're shooting at, but normally when we're out shooting, even with the earmuffs and without a suppressor, you don't really hear the bullet hit whatever it hits very much. I mean, here hit the steel targets, but it's just different when you've got a suppressor on there. It's pretty cool. Pretty cool. Plus, that rifle's pretty cool. I still like the SCAR.
And one thing, I remember there were some comments on the video about how we should have used subsonic ammo.
Oh, yeah.
And it kind of, with the 308, it defeats the purpose a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you're using subsonic with a 308, you essentially have 300 blackouts.
That's right. Basically. Yeah. Yeah, and that's another, I guess, misconception. You're not necessarily trying to quiet it down to where it's totally silent anyway.
But it depends on what gun you have.
Yeah, and the purpose and all that stuff.
Like, it would be like if you had an AR and you wanted to shoot subsonic ammo. That doesn't really make any sense.
Yeah, then you got a 22 long rifle.
Right, yeah, exactly.
Or 22 short.
Right.
If it's going to be really subsonic.
Yeah. But on those types of guns with supersonic ammo, it does quieten it down quite a bit.
It does. Well, the military guys will tell you that, I've seen your comments. You military guys, I know a lot of you watch the videos and write me, but I've seen your comments about how, straightening people out on that occasionally is that it's what it does if you're out in the jungle or in the desert or wherever you are and you're actually in combat in some special situation maybe, it doesn't eliminate the sound of the rifle. But it makes it more difficult to know where it came from, that sort of thing. You don't hear it as far away.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah, so anyway, there we go. Let's talk about suppressors for 25 minutes.
Yeah.
Oh, well, again, that's why we do the radio shows and we do stupid stuff like this. Because in our videos, even though we're pretty relaxed and we have a gun to talk about, and we don't want people to stumble into one of our gun videos and see us acting like this and think, well, that was really interesting. I'll never go back to that. I mean, it's about a gun. It's what we're doing with the firearm. So this is for us. Maybe it's for you, if you enjoy this kind of silliness. But we enjoy just doing this because we can talk to you in a more relaxed way. And maybe you learn something you didn't know or you figure out something about why we do what we do. I don't know. Maybe you just go to sleep and turn it off. I don't know. What do you think, John?
I think they're all asleep right now.
Well, I know one thing we didn't mention was the meet and greets we wrapped up not too long ago, right?
Yeah.
With the last one. Speaking of Bud's Gun Shop at their new location. Those are, and I talked about that in a radio show, I think, but we did the meet and greets as just kind of sounding altruistic. It was kind of a, to give back. You guys are so supportive, and in this close proximity, at least fairly close, we did all these meet and greets on our own dime, traveling wherever we were going. Some of them were overnight, that kind of thing, but they weren't all that far away. We can't just run around and do one in Dallas, next weekend. I mean, it would get pretty expensive, but we ran around Kentucky and Tennessee and went to East Tennessee and got to meet a bunch of funny looking people and up to Whitaker's in Owensboro, Kentucky and around Lexington, Sevierville, and did one or two or three at Indianapolis, the NRA convention, and we'll continue doing that probably at those conventions. But anyway, the meet and greets, that was a new thing for us, I guess, over the last year.
Yeah.
And
it's nice to get that feedback. Talk to someone face to face and
yeah, it is.
And get feedback.
It is, and to meet you funny looking people out there on the other side of the computer screen.
Yeah.
Or TV, John. Some of them watch on TV.
Yeah.
On their TV screen at least.
Oh, right? Yeah, okay.
They have a smart TV like you do.
Yeah. That's kind of ironic, smart TV.
Yeah, that's oxymoron.
Yeah.
But anyway, those were good. We enjoyed them. They're a little tiring, but I enjoyed them. It was neat meeting you all and your families and various parts of at least these two states. And well, the NRA convention, we met people from all over the country, I guess. But it's pretty cool. Enjoyed that.
Yeah. And how nice of us to offer both a meet and a greet.
That's right.
Yeah.
Right. I did the meeting.
One.
John did the greeting. Right?
Yeah.
Was there any common denominator in all those? I don't know. We met a lot of you. A lot of you. I guess one common denominator is which is extremely pleasing, which I talk about occasionally and with John, is that you guys are pretty normal, actually. And from a broad cross-section of folks, really young, little people. You've seen some of the pictures I've posted. 20-something, 30-something, 40, I mean, all ages, old guys, young guys, and it's good to know you old guys are on the internet, but all age groups, you know, seem to prowl around and land on our videos occasionally, you know, looks like.
So by accident.
By accident, yeah, they're actually looking for something intelligent, and they end up on our, oh, I know another gun we were going to talk about, is this one right here. Yeah, this is the Ott-3 Springfield, the A3. And yeah, I have the regular Ott-3 that was made in 1918.
Used by Alvin York, right?
Yeah, Alvin York carried this one. But, you never know what those people carried, you know, various times. This one was actually used, the 1918 model was used. And I wanted one with a better sight. I like the peep sight, and it's kind of redundant. If the Ott-3, the other one I had a sight I could use, I would not have necessarily wanted this one. But I love these old bolt guns, these Ott-3 bolt guns, Springfields. They're just so special. And so I fell in love even more after getting the 1918 Ott-3. And been kind of watching for one of these. I acquired this one a few months ago at the Louisville gun show. And it's got the sight back here, the peep sight, the A3, as many of you already know. And it's just like sighting down an AR-15 or something. You know, it's just great. If your eyes aren't perfect, you still got that benefit of the peep sight, the aperture sight. And you got those on the original A3s, but it's very complex and I can't seem to get it to work.
It's like, if you think about it, it's like the ultimate bolt gun. You get the best of the Mauser, basically, and then the Garand with the peep sight.
That's right. That's right. You really do. And it's beautiful. I've got to apologize. I have to apologize all over the place. One thing we've tried to do in recent months, years, we got a few videos where I didn't have my sights on, and I was laboring to hit even fairly easy targets with rifles. Couple of times, I think a Mosin video, maybe something else along the way. I think the scars that I'd borrowed or something in the early videos. But so I try not to do that anymore. And I thought I had the sights on this thing. I pulled it out here and shot after I bought it. And wow, right on the plates, you know, that's where I thought I was aiming. And good, I'd expected sights are right on. You know, I didn't shoot it a lot. Yeah, I put it away and everything. I tell this in a video we did on it just recently. The stock started splitting on me. I guess it already had started. And I replaced the stock, found a new one. It's not new, it's an old one at the Knob Creek Gun Show. And I replaced it. It's a pretty stock. And so anyway, I took a few shots, and then we did a video the other day.
Well, you told me you carved it up yourself.
Yeah, I'll do the next one. But anyway, the sights were not on. I was struggling a little bit in the video. That's not the main point of the video, the marksmanship or anything, but I was having trouble hitting even the red plates with it. Well, as you know, after the video, I figured it out. I got it out yesterday. I said, I got to work with that thing and see if that was me, because I thought this thing was a marvelous shooter. And yesterday, John was there, nobody was around. I just got out in very casual, leisurely fashion. Put up a paper target, and I said, okay, I'm gonna find out if in that video a few days before I was just flinching like crazy or what the heck it was. And I took my time and I got down on the shooting bench, and you know, I didn't get a bench rest out, but I got some paper. I took two or three shots and four or five, and sure enough, they were low right significantly, even at like 25 yards. And so I moved the sights quite a bit and got it on. Okay, so now just keep that in mind when you see the video. It was the sights. That might have been me too, but it is the sights. And it's shooting low, and I think that elevation part of that has a little trouble staying up where I put it, so I may have to do a little work on that. But anyway, I figured out the sights. So chapter two, no excuses. But anyway, these are beautiful guns, and you'll be seeing them in living color before long in a video. What else are we going to talk about? You know, the guns strike you as interesting recently? Mm. We've probably only been going for about 4 hours now.
Yeah. No, nothing comes to mind.
Nothing. Well, I'm not sure what else to talk about. We could probably think of something to just barely mention and then go off in about 20 minutes.
Yeah. We probably could.
Okay. Well, we appreciate y'all stopping by. It's kind of interesting that you would be here in the woods with us. I don't know how you ended up here, but we appreciate you all watching.
And we appreciate our viewer who's still awake.
Yeah, the three?
No, our viewer, yeah, our one viewer.
The one, yeah, probably so. Well, we do these kinds of things for the most, euphemistically, I say most loyal viewers, but what we really mean are the craziest viewers, right? That would listen to us for this long. Well, we really have, over the years, we have learned just from communicating with you all and seeing you at meetings and greetings, that a lot of you do enjoy the videos, and we've gotten to know you, and I've exchanged lots of communications with some of you, as many as I can.
And learned a lot from our fans.
Yeah, we've learned
something that I always like to say, because we really did. We learned a lot from them.
We have. Learned a lot about everything, guns and you name it. Get lots of interesting messages, and I say read them all. I can't answer them all, but I read them all. And even the troll. So if you're one of those trolls, one of those hateful, envious trolls, yeah, you can write a message. I'll probably read it, you know, just before I block you. No, there's going to be haters, as I've said before. If you're doing anything, well, you know what? As I said, I think in the last radio show, if you don't have some haters, you better check your pulse, because you might not be alive. You know, you might not be, you know, out there getting something done, because you're going to have those folks. But no, we have met a lot of you, and I think it gives us license to kind of be ourselves and to talk to you, I guess, fairly frankly, and just be honest with you about things, because we know that the vast majority of you are supportive, and you seem to like at least some of what we do, and we're going to keep doing it. I mean, to heck with the 0.1%. We don't really care if that 0.1% doesn't like what we do. That's totally irrelevant.
Because we're confident in...
Yeah, because we're confident that enough of you do.
Yeah. Number one, we want to support the Second Amendment. That's number one. And then number two is our unbiased, other than personal bias.
Right.
Gun reviews, basically, and whatever else we decide to do.
Exactly.
Except for ammo. We don't review ammo.
Yeah, we don't really review.
Because we have a nice sponsorship from Federal. And we never reviewed ammo really in the first place anyway, so not a big deal.
Yeah, John is right on the unbiased, except for our personal biases. We definitely have personal biases. It doesn't bother me a bit when somebody makes a comment about, well, he likes Glocks better or he likes this better. Yeah, I might. I try to be objective, though, even when I'm dealing with a firearm that is not my favorite. I hope you notice that. And on the ammo, we love that support from Federal. But as I told them early on, in writing, that we'd love to have their support, but there would be times when we would be, maybe we've got a firearm, a pistol especially, it maybe has a reputation for being finicky, or it's just a brand new, like the Glock 42, I think. I've dragged out a bunch of 380, including Federal, of course, just to see if it would run.
Right. Yeah, but it's not really ammo review. It's more just a demonstration, scientific experience.
We don't really review ammo. It's like 10 Outdoors 9 or somebody does or did. Hopefully we'll do again. But we're biased personally maybe on some things, but that's about it. But we feel comfortable with you guys, because we know that you're interested in learning about firearms. And as John has always said, we do videos about firearms the way we would like to see them done, the videos we would like to see. Is that the line, John?
Yeah.
Something like that.
That's how you should do everything.
Yeah.
That's how music used to be, and that's how everything should be. You do what you would like to see, because that's the only way you can be sure about what you're doing. If you're only trying to do something to pander to some certain audience that you want,
right,
then it's not, it can't be genuine. There's no way, and I think people can tell. So.
Well, we're not perfect, but we enjoy what we do, and we're going to be up front with you. And we've yakked too long about all sorts of things we didn't think we were going to even talk about that much.
Yep.
But that's what you get. That's what you get for turning on the stupid computer.
Especially when both of us here in front of the camera, and I'm too far away to see how long the video is.
That's right.
So that creates a problem. But see, if I'm filming, I can see how long it is.
Or he'd give me a signal.
Come on, Dad, let's go. Time to wrap it up.
He'd give me a signal. 25 minutes. There's nobody to do that now. We're probably at 3 hours. Yep. So anyway, we enjoy what we're doing, and we enjoy the relationship we've established with all of you to some extent. Even the haters, I guess you could say we have a hateful relationship, right?
That's right.
I guess we maybe shouldn't do these together like this. So anyway, we appreciate y'all watching. Let's shut up. Life is good.